Hey guys, Spy Honey here with another Animorphs vlog. This time it's book 41, The Familiar. And yeah, something's very familiar about this morph. It's almost like it didn't morph at all, it just aged up. This is quite the book. It starts with a particularly brutal battle. Everybody's like hanging on by the skin of their teeth. Cassie just had to like murder an alien, and she's more upset about it than usual. And Jake's like, come on guys, we just gotta get home, we're done. And he just brushes Cassie off and goes to bed, falls asleep, wakes up, he's 25 years old, and he's in a future in which the Yerks won. Show the inside cover and such a jerk. So yeah, this is the future that the Yerks want. So Jake's trying to piece together what's going on. He's pretty sure he's going crazy and that this is basically his pad. So he's wearing an orange jumpsuit. He gets together with a bunch of people all with color-coded jumpsuits, finds out that they're all controllers, and the Yerks have basically taken over Earth and are adding their architecture to ours so that New York City looks like it's just infested by these boils of Yerk architecture over top of our iconic buildings. The Twin Towers is like a prominent thing. That's where a lot of spaceships land. Which is so jarring to read now in, you know, 2020. He freaks out. He ends up, so basically the city, the top of the city is all the modern Yerk architecture and stuff. The bottom of the city's a burnt out husk of human artifacts and, you know, just an abandoned city for the most part. So Jake finds himself in this part of the city, and it is there that he meets the evolutionists or something, the EF, which is like the resistance group. They are a group of basically disabled, mentally ill, neurodivergent people who are unfit as hosts, and so they're kind of thrown out, and they band together and they try to survive. Cassie is a controller in this universe, and she's also like a badass action hero, revolutionary terrorist who has been making a dent in the Yerks' forces in the absence of the other Animorphs. Because we later learn that she tells us that Rachel died, Marco is now like the leader of the Yerk forces on Earth. Axe became a controller and his Yerk led the campaign against the Andalite homeworld and killed like most of the Andalites. And now the remaining Andalites are all controllers. Tobias is the only one who escaped. He's kind of just roaming now. They assume that Jake died. Cassie's like, okay, well, since you're like a planetary engineer, you can help us with our mission. And she's like complete opposite of what Cassie is now. She has none of the heart or the optimism or the idealism. She's just like all business, and Jake is really put off by this, and so was I. I could see that development coming though, because I have seen in quite a few of her battles she gets like more and more ruthless. So it's like this seems like it was a matter of time given the course they are headed. So Jake's like, wait a minute, I just woke up like this. I'm not a planetary engineer. And Cassie's like, we'll give you the orders you follow, don't question them. He tries to go through his workday as normal while also kind of being pursued and watched by the security aliens known as the Orph. The Orph are nearly invisible, translucent. You can see their organs through all their skin and muscle and bone. They use these like living handcuffs that are really gross. But they're basically the security force. And as Jake later learns, their organs are actually decoys. You have to like kick them in weird places to get them to actually go down. Because their real organs are invisible. That's a pretty neat concept, even though I can't really visualize them because they're nearly invisible. They're three-legged, and their irises orbit around their pupils? What? So anyway, normal work day, wherein Jake puts on his, like, VR headset thing and does the brain computer thing to the best of his ability. But then all of his co-workers turn into all of the aliens he has murdered throughout his campaign as an Animorph. And they all start crawling towards him like zombies going, Jake, Jake. And so Jake freaks out, the Orph come in, he morphs Tiger to try to fight them off. And then they like knock him out, demorph him, and take him to Marco. And Marco is very unsettling because, like, the Yurk who replaced him is, like, a sociopath. Complete disregard for humanity and almost takes sadistic pleasure in interrogating and torturing people. And then there's one brief moment where he lets Marco speak and Marco just, like, there's a change coming over, a change completely comes over his face. The real Marco is horrified and he's like, I think he tries to say sorry or something, and it's really heartbreaking. And then the Yurk rubs it in further by trying to use Marco's pattern of humor to terrible effect. Yeah, without Marco, this is not a very funny book. It's very, very bleak. So at first Jake's not talking, and then Marco's like, okay, well, I have ways of making you talk, and then he doesn't say that, but that's basically the gist of it. And then he brings in Cassie. And he threatens to have Cassie eaten by an especially sadistic taxon. Marco sees Cassie in distress, and he's like, Jake sees Cassie in distress, and he's like, okay, I'll tell you everything. And so he does. And Cassie's like, damn it! So, because Cassie is like willing to die for this cause, and she does not care if she dies. And, I keep saying Marco. And Jake definitely cares. So that's a constant theme of the book, is that Jake is constantly having to decide between Cassie and the mission to save all of humanity. So Marco lets him go, but he keeps Cassie. And Jake goes to this like banquet party thing. He like stuffs his face with food for a bit. He meets a Horkbajor ally of the EF, and then he's directed to make like he's going to leave the party, but then double back and go to the kitchen, and that's where he meets Rachel. Turns out Rachel's not dead, she's just horribly disfigured and crippled. However, that doesn't seem to bother her much, she doesn't want pity, she just tells Jake, go ahead with the plan. So he's still like on the fence about what to do. Basically the plan is, the Yurks want to shoot the moon and burn it so that it becomes a Kondrona sun. I almost said Corona. However, their controlled burn of the moon is a very precise matter. If they're off by even a little bit, the moon will just explode. So that's their plan, is to mess up the laser enough so that it blows up the moon instead of turning into a sun. Okay. Even for Animorphs, that's a little bit outlandish, which kind of clues you in. So, I mean, there's a bunch of things that clue you in. Jake's hallucination, the fact that he'll randomly, like, teleport to different locations, it all started reminding me of the season, I believe it was the season 4 finale of She-Ra, where Catra opens a portal into an alternate dimension that's basically a mass hallucination where everybody is in their ideal future, but Adora, being She-Ra, kind of notices that things are a bit off, that she's like jumping from location to location, that people aren't quite acting like themselves, and she sees like flashes of reality breaking around her, and you slowly start to realize that none of this is real. That's kind of what this book it feels like. And so that clued me into the big plot twist later on. Okay, so Jake's about to slam into this laser to knock it off course, and then he sees Cassie tied to the tower. This is starting to look like a typical superhero comic book situation where it's like you can either save your girlfriend or you can defuse the bomb. Or like the scene in the one Spider-Man movie where I think his Green Goblin holds like a tram full of innocent civilians and then Mary Jane, and it's like you can only save one. It seemed a little contrived, and I think that was intentional. Jake goes after Cassie, and then he ends up in a situation where he can either defuse the satellite or, you know, knock it off course, or Cassie tries to escape, something drags her down. She gets knocked off the edge of the building and is holding on by one hand and is about to lose her grip in a few seconds. So Jake only has time to either stop the laser that's going to go off in a few seconds or save his girlfriend who's going to die in a few seconds. He says he makes his decision, but he doesn't say what that decision is. And then he wakes to a voice telling him, "Oh, this is very interesting. Humans have both their subconscious and conscious desires. This requires further studying." And like, he knows it's not the Elements, but it's definitely some sort of godlike alien messing with his head. So he wakes up and immediately calls Cassie and says, like, "Look, if you want to talk, please talk." And that's how it ends. And I think that implies what decision he made in the end. This was an interesting book. It seems like it's a bit of filler, but I feel like whoever came up with that thing is, whatever it is, hallucination, dream, potentially an actual timeline, is going to come back. So yeah, that was an interesting look into what the future will be if the Animorphs don't win. And also a cautionary tale about checking up on your friends, because if you don't, then your world will turn to a dystopic nightmare and alien slugs will take over everybody's brains and your friends will all become slaves to the Yurik Empire. So call your friends, people.